Well, here we go again. This is Doom once again on an IBM RS6000. You might think I've already done this video, and I kinda have, but this time we're on Windows. Specifically, Windows NT4 for PowerPC. This is your host, End Commander, and today we're going to dive into the rarely seen world of the RISC-based ports of Windows. Before we begin though, there's been some pretty exciting news in the world of weird Windows that you might already be aware of if you watch Michael MJD. A user known as Rairii managed to get the PowerPC port of Windows NT working on specific PowerBook and PowerMac models. This magic trick was done by writing a new hardware abstraction layer and making an Arc environment available on top of Apple's open firmware implementation. Now, to be clear, I'm not going to be using his work in this video as I have actual prep hardware, and frankly, Michael did a great job in covering it already. What you'll see here is how much of Windows NT for PowerPC is just a pile of hot garbage, and ultimately received only 2 of a total of 6.5 service packs. That is a lot of missing bug fixes. With that said, for those who attended VCF East in 2023, this machine was part of a larger presentation I called The World of PowerPC, documenting Motorola's efforts to stay relevant in the face of growing dominance of Intel's x86 architecture. While building that presentation, I livestreamed most of my efforts on getting NT working on the RS6000, and some sneak peeks of Solaris for PowerPC going on a Motorola PowerStack 2 that I had gotten as a donation earlier that year. Let's start with the hardware. We are seeing Windows NT4 running on an IBM RS6000 7043-140 Model 140 with a 233 MHz PowerPC 604E processor and 64 MB of memory. This model was originally released in 1997, and RS6000s, as a general rule, normally ran IBM's port of Unix known as AIX. This specific RS6000 was used by an energy company based out of Texas and was running AIX when I picked it up in 2022 at a VCF swap meet. I've already covered much of the history of the RS6000 as well as AIX in an hour-long video I released a little over 2 years ago. I recommend watching that video after this one if you want to know more about what these machines were normally like, but let's talk about Windows NT first. Now, NT is a topic that pretty much every vintage computer channel on YouTube has covered before, but for the lucky 1 in 10,000 who hasn't heard of it before, Windows NT was originally created as part of Microsoft's work with IBM to create a successor to the 16-bit versions of DOS, Windows, and OS 2, and is still used today as the basis for Windows 11. Unlike Microsoft's previous operating systems, which were limited to running on Intel x86 compatible machines, NT was specifically designed not to be tied to a singular hardware platform. This is a property known in operating system design as portability. To ensure this, NT's kernel was originally coded for Intel's i86 architecture, which isn't x86 compatible, before then being ported to MIPS, and then again to Intel's x86 architecture. As it was released in 1993, Windows NT 3.1 Advanced Server was released with the x86 and MIPS port. Support for DEC Alpha then quickly followed as part of an updated release of NT 3.1 in late 1993. Said port was due to DEC threatening legal action over aspects of NT's kernel being similar to their VMS product. PowerPC support would be the last of the RISC ports added to NT, with it first appearing in NT 3.5.1 in 1995. Collectively, these ports represent Microsoft's first real forays into non-x86 architectures, and are collectively known as the RISC ports of Windows NT. They'd also all be dead before the release of Windows 2000. As far as official hardware goes, Windows NT for PowerPC will only run on a very small subset of Motorola and IBM machines produced between 1995 and 1997. Technically speaking, my RS6000 Model 140 is actually too new. It was released shortly after the NT port was end-of-lifed. In its stock configuration, you can load the Arc boot floppy and start the NT installation, but it'll die shortly afterwards complaining about a missing video card driver, as the stock GTX 255 graphics card is incompatible. However, the Model 140 that I'm using is what's known as a PowerPC reference platform or prep machine, so it's not as hopeless as it might seem. Later RS6000s, such as the Model 150 in which I did the original AIX Doom video on, are built around IBM's Common Hardware Reference Platform or CHRP standard, which is incompatible with older prep operating systems. As for the graphics, the problem of incompatible video cards is a fairly well-known issue with the PowerPC port of Windows NT, and made more complicated by the fact that you seem to require a video card that works both with the graphics mode of the RS6000's firmware and is supported by NT itself. A potential workaround though might be using the GTX 255 card in tandem with an S3 or other supported video card, on the theory that NT would simply initialize the second card. I didn't try that, but maybe someone out there will. I'd love to tell you that I figured out some clever hack to make this work, but really I just got lucky on knowing what to search for on eBay. Specifically, I found an IBM branded WeTek P90 card, which was available as an upgrade for various models of the RS6000 and is also supported by NT. With this video card installed, we're off to the races. NT4's installation on PowerPC is almost identical to that on XA6, but I ran into a rather annoying issue. Whenever the installer tried to initialize the onboard AMD PCNet Ethernet device, the system would crash and blue screen. Lovely. The AMD PCNet PCI driver is part of Windows NT itself and ships as a stock driver. I have this feeling that this driver was likely compiled by Microsoft but never actually tested, as I'm not certain if any of the few machines that supported NT PowerPC actually used it. Fortunately, by simply disabling networking, I can skip past this step. Not long after, I threw in a Freecom Etherlink PCI card in the system, which worked just fine, so at least it wasn't a showstopper. The rest of the Windows NT installation went without a hitch, and after a reboot, I found myself at the login screen. After logging in as administrator and adjusting the colors and resolution to something more readable, we're ready to begin. On the surface, the PowerPC port of Windows NT is identical to the XA6 version. However, looks are deceiving. The biggest problem is that there's no support for running 32-bit x86 applications. Or well, that's what the original take of this video said. What I should have said is, it can't run 32-bit applications without add-on software. Out of the box, limited support for 16-bit Windows and DOS applications is provided through software emulation via NTVDM, but it's not very good. I had known that DEC had released FX32 for their Alpha architecture to enable 32-bit compatibility for their systems, but was unaware of any such product for MIPS or PowerPC. However, Michael MJD demonstrated an unknown-to-me product known as Soft Windows 32 for PowerPC, which does just that. I suspect a fair number of Windows 95 programs would run on it, but in general, native applications were going to be preferable to emulated ones. As such, a native build of Doom was up next, but Microsoft's tooling for the job is what the industry likes to call hot garbage. We'll get to that though. Moving forward, the next steps were installing Service Pack 2, followed by Visual C++ for PowerPC. And it's here where our problems begin. Unlike later ports of Windows, or even Windows CE from this era, Microsoft didn't ship cross-compilers for NT. If you want to build an application for any of the RISC versions of Windows NT, you needed both the hardware and the correct copy of Visual C++ for said hardware. This is no doubt a major factor in the lack of any third-party software for any of the RISC ports. It also doesn't help that I found Visual C++ for PowerPC to be immensely unstable. Adding insult to injury, it would oftentimes corrupt the project files it was working on, making this a hair-pulling experience. That rather large issue aside, after Visual C++4 finished installing, I confirmed that I could build a simple Hello World binary. As you might expect, I also have a full debugger, and everything more or less works the same as in the XA6 version. This was then followed by the Windows SDK, since I learned from experience that you shouldn't try and build third-party code without it. This includes a lot of headers and link libraries for graphics, videos, and sound APIs that we'll no doubt need. I also made sure some of the included examples worked as expected. Fun fact, I learned the source code to that old 3D Maze screensaver is shipped here as an example of how to use OpenGL. But now, it was time to compile. NetHack, of course. Wait, NetHack? Well, frankly, I wasn't entirely sure I could get Chocolate Doom to build, and my previous experience with building stuff on Windows NT MIPS seemed to tell me that I was in for a pretty miserable time. NetHack is written in KNRC that's been fed through more compilers than most people will ever use in their life. It is an extremely portable codebase that I've yet to see any 90s-era compiler puke up yet. I've personally found it a good litmus test to make sure your environment works as expected. Accordingly, it was a non-event to get it to build. NetHack ships an makefile that just runs CL directly, and a few minutes later, I have a fresh adventurer ready to go. I did try to get the tiles mode to build, but it went belly up. I'm not certain if NetHack has issues on NT4 or if this was a PowerPC specific issue, but I didn't spend much time debugging it. I prefer ASCII anyway. Now it was time for the main event, Doom, or more specifically, Chocolate Doom. Chocolate Doom is a port of the game to the simple direct media library known as SDL for short. Older versions of SDL didn't require advanced graphics APIs to work either, and as such, when doing a quick and dirty Doom port, it's one of the easiest ways to go. Now, I'm pretty sure any of us who have used Windows have had DirectX problems in the past. Here, we get to see DirectX sucking by not existing at all. Or well, it's complicated. DirectX, for that 1 in 10,000 who didn't know, is Microsoft's graphics and multimedia API for 3D graphics and gaming. It was available for Windows NT, but only in the form of DirectX 2 and 3, which were fairly limited. Version 2 was available on release of NT4, but version 3 was only available after Service Pack 3, which was never released for NT on PowerPC. SDL doesn't require DirectX to be available on the runtime system. It was, after all, an optional component, and many simpler games can get by with Microsoft's older DIB rendering engine. It does, however, require it to compile, which means I had to surgically remove support for DirectX and hope that a 233MHz PowerPC processor was up to the job of software rendering. That, however, wasn't the hard part. The hard part was figuring out how to build it in the first place. SDL ships a set of Visual C++ project files for version 2003. I have a version that's not quite 4.1, and it seems to have compatibility issues every time I've played with it before. That's a problem. Fortunately, it's one with a workable solution. By loading the project files in a Windows XP VM, I can open them in Visual C++ 2003 and export a makefile. This process isn't perfect, and some massaging is necessary to get the PowerPC and make to accept it, but it's a lot better than having to recreate the project files by hand. There were still, however, a few odds and ends to fix. Of the ones I remember, it was defining PowerPC as a little endian platform, since Windows NT on PowerPC runs in little endian mode. That's a detail that will probably interest exactly one person, who will know why that's interesting and has already posted about it in the comments section. Anyway, after a bunch of hacking, I ended up with a release build of SDL and SDL main. Now, I'd love to tell you that I learned my lesson this time and ran the test suites, but I didn't see an easy way to build them under Windows, and honestly, I was running out of time before VCF. We're now entering into the realm of the demo gods. May they be kind. Having gone libSDL already, the two necessary add-on libraries, SDLNet and SDLMixer, were much more of the same, export makefile and then build. I didn't even have to make any code changes. Chocolate Doom, though, wouldn't be so straightforward. Unlike SDL or any of its add-on libraries, Chocolate Doom had multiple sublibraries that comes together to create the end product. While I could export makefiles from Visual C++ 2003, I had a lot of issues in getting them to build. I ultimately ended up making a self-contained project file to build doompc.exe. However, Visual C++ for PowerPC kept crashing, and when it crashed, it would often corrupt the project files on the disk. This was probably one of the most miserable things I've done with a development tool in a while. I'm not convinced any sort of QA was done here either. Still, with perseverance comes progress, and I eventually got Doom built and working. It's a rough port, and it's one I can't release publicly right now, mostly because it's on a hard drive on a machine 3,000 miles away, but once I get a chance, I'll get it up on GitHub. I can, however, make NetHack available, as I left a compiled version of it on my Raspberry Pi. This also marks the end of part 2 of what I assume will be a 3-part series on the world of PowerPC processors. If you want to see part 3 and other stories like it, consider supporting my channel with the links below. I'm hoping to grow my channel to 50,000 subscribers this year, so every little bit helps. As always, this is your host, End Commander, signing out and wishing you all a pleasant day.